All right. Hello, everyone. It is 4:05. We had to grace ourselves a few extra minutes to get ourselves situated and come out of that amazing, magnificent talk we just finished with Vincent Powell. This series is just, it's humbling, really. The time and care that everyone is giving to our students, giving to Prairie View, giving to the people that are watching on YouTube, giving to the students at Dillard University who are watching right now. They're not in the chat room with us today. They were here on Tuesday. They will be back with us next Tuesday, but they are watching on YouTube. Students from Lawson State Community College, they're watching as well. We're growing a community that is thriving during this time, during this pandemic. It's not stopping us. It's not stopping our creativity. And I just want to say thank you to everyone who's participating, from the speakers to the students to the viewers to everyone who's involved. Our next speaker, our next guest lecturer is a guy who's very special to me. I met Patrick in Atlanta, 2013. Man. Ooh, I put a date on it, didn't I?
It's crazy.
And when I met Patrick, he was acting. He was starting to gain some legs there in Atlanta. He was very certain. One thing I remember about first working with Patrick was he was very clear about his goals and what he wanted and where he was going. And I'd say during that time too, Atlanta was really proving itself to be, and still is, proving itself to be a great playground for young Black artists who wanted to just see what they can do in the industry. As actors, as directors, I had the great fortune of working with some people where I was able to direct a couple music videos, some short films. And my first time working with Patrick was actually on my labor of love, my superhero story, Genesis. I paired up with a wonderful team of people who helped us do what we could. And because it was a superhero film and it required special effects, and you know, for about 6 months, it looked like, you know, a particular producer was going to produce it for us. And when that deal fell through, my tribe just rallied around and said, "Let's just shoot what we can. Let's do what we can." And I cast Patrick as the lead of the film, as one of the five siblings who were superheroes. And the story is told through the eyes of a character named Quincy. I am going to play that video.
Oh, so man.
You all can see, I reached back and got it. Hold on a second.
Really?
Let me come out of this real quick. There we go. And I'm gonna play what we ended up shooting as a trailer. A little teaser. It was a scene teaser. And then, well, I'll talk about what happened afterwards, after the piece. So let's go to it.
thing if you told me. But come on, yo, quantum physics. And you're in here reading X-Men. Come on,
bro,
this is
college. We're playing
this perfect SAT. I never miss a class. And it nearly kills me from slipping to a B in my classes. We're in the same classes. And I never see you with anything other than them damn comic books.
You okay?
Yeah.
Your face turned red or anything?
Yeah, I said I'm fine. Why do you buy these anyway? They're still in the wrap.
I know you. I know you'd be here. Asking me for some note cards. That man just can't be smart.
I heard that. Look, just do me a favor. Pick up a book.
What? It's a book. Sam.
What?
I know it's you.
So, what I didn't know that is was if I mute my mic, it mutes the sound.
Oh.
So they were, I see they were in the chat room saying, was it supposed to be silent? Y'all couldn't hear it? Could you hear it, Patrick?
I couldn't hear it too much, but I know the link. I'm gonna watch it after we finish.
Okay, maybe at the very, very end, I'll just run the beginning again, because apparently if I silent my mic, he said it was a Charlie Chaplin action. Get out of here, man. that's funny. I muted my mic thinking that I didn't want to disturb the playback, and then turns out me muting the mic muted the video. But, you know, we'll go back to it a little bit later on then. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce Mr. Patrick Walker. Patrick hails from Florida. You're from Florida?
Yes, Jacksonville, Florida.
Yeah. Yo. Made his way to Atlanta, Georgia, and then from there parlayed his opportunities in Atlanta to a stellar career in Los Angeles. But what strikes me most about Patrick and watching him work and watching him grow is that man is not ever satisfied. When he is not shooting an episode of Grey's Anatomy, he is shooting an episode of Iron Fist when it was on. When he wasn't shooting an episode of Iron Fist, he was shooting an episode of Power. When he wasn't on Power, he found himself on The Resident. And when he's not doing these pieces, did the HBO film
The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks.
One more time?
The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks.
There you go. Thank you. Yeah. When he's not doing the work that, you know, one would go, oh, he's made it. He has created, he's creating his own work. He is constantly shooting short scenes that will allow people to see his work, not only as a performer, but also as a director and as a producer and as a writer. Instead of showcasing his work as, okay, I'm going to shoot all these things and here's my reel, he shoots these short vignettes, if you will, and they stand alone on Instagram, or they stand alone on whatever platform he puts them on. And he's like, no, that's the thing. It's not me trying to give you a compilation and sell me to you. This is the story I'm choosing to tell in this moment. And I just love it. I love watching you work, brother. And I appreciate you giving your time to us today. Thank you so much.
No problem.
The flow today is going to be, you know, we'll take a few minutes, you know, introduce yourself, who you are and what you do. We'll talk about how the pandemic is affecting you, your state of mind, your well-being, your work, and then we'll turn it over to you to teach us a thing. So why don't you start off by telling us who you are and what you do in the world?
So my name is Patrick. First of all, Patrick Walker. I am first an actor, and then, like you just said, then director, producer, all those beautiful things. But just like you, like the main thing that I took from what you said was, I don't like to sit still. You know, like people can say it was bad when you're young, but I think like now that I'm older, like I'm not satisfied with just being in one place. I mean, obviously, even now, like doing shows that like I finished over the course of like 2019, I was working on a resident for two seasons, and then hopping in and out of Power, and then finishing Power, and then finishing really all of these projects, and then coming to a what I call like a small standstill, because from moving to LA, I mean, I just booked a movie that I have to go to, like after this pandemic, it was supposed to be shot now, but I have to go to Columbia to shoot a feature that I'm really excited about now, as soon as this is over. But in between that time, like in December, like, you know, just shooting projects and then pitching those projects to different networks, from obviously like meeting different people on sets, but just like getting those contacts and letting them know that like I do other things besides just act. So that has really been the course of like my past year, 2 years, just really focusing on myself outside of the audition. Okay, cool. You get an audition. What time? Go over the lines. Go to audition. Perform for these people that you know sometimes and that you do not know. I think no offense to anybody, but there was a moment last year where I had an audition and I went in for three people who it was an urban story, but it was three people who were nowhere near the color that the characters were. They had to then judge me on my performance that I gave. And I realized when I walked in and did it for them and I left, I was like, I don't like the feeling of like just like my life depending on people who may not like understand my point of view on this character. So then, you know, people get it, you know, because they know what's good, they'll take what's good. And it's like being so close to so many roles, I think it's like, it messes with like your brain after a while. Like last year I tested for three shows. So it's like in my brain, it's three chances. It's like you're close to $1 million three times, you know, for like close to changing your life for your family three times. And I'm like, you know what? Like if I just make my own things and do my own, then I can gauge my own life and I can deter. I know where I'm going by the work that I'm doing on my own, not just when I read a 9-page audition and go in and have 3 to 5 minutes in a room with somebody and then they determine, oh, you're good enough. Come on and we'll change your life. I want to just be in charge of like my life. So yeah, that has been the course as of recent, as of late.
Wow. Talk to us about your starts, your beginnings. You know, when I met you, where were you in your stage of your career at that point? Because we met at the auditions for Genesis. But I also instantly got the feeling that you, while there was some greenness to you, there was this energy about you where you were just a ball of clay. Like you were ready to go in any direction. Tell us about, you know, your starts.
So Genesis was a part of the early start. Like I had done nothing. I think like I was going to acting classes faithfully, giving this acting coach all my money. Which is my dog, but like giving everything I had to these acting classes, doing like small, really, really small independent projects. And at that moment of Genesis, that was the biggest thing. That was like the most important and the biggest thing. And funny thing about it is like that day that I went to that audition essentially was, I think that there are moments that like change the trajectory of your life. And that was a big moment. And you may not know this, but I'll explain to you why. So I was acting and stuff like that. My friend, my own destiny, she was...
my own Red Summer's daughter.
Yeah, Red Summer's daughter, yeah.
Well, Red Summer was a speaker last week on here.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, so I dated her daughter. So I was dating my own at the time. And she knew I was in classes. And she knew I was an actor. And she was like, hey, why don't you come... this play I'm doing, we're having play rehearsals at this place. And we may need another guy to come in and play this role. Would you do it, please? I was like, all right, cool.
Yeah.
So I come, I'm watching them do this rehearsal for this play, and they didn't need me. Like she said, they needed me. So I'm watching and I'm like, okay, I didn't get any sides. I didn't get anything. So I see this happening. So I decided to go to the bathroom. So what I did was I walked out of there. I went to the bathroom and it was a bunch of talk coming from like this. It was in a gym, I believe. It was a bunch of talking, a lot of chatter coming from the back because there was a lot of people there. And then someone walked by, and it was like a movie. Somebody walked by and I said, what's going on back there? They said, this movie, it's auditions for a movie. You should go audition. Literally, that's what they said. You should go audition. And that person just went on, never saw them again, but walked in, like, and the lady said, like, are you here to audition? I said, yeah, can anybody audition? She says, yes. I get these sides. I get paired up with Blair, who was the guy who's in the video.
My God.
Yeah, Blair was like, did my first headshot, but
yeah.
Paired up with Blair, had that whole experience where you had us like bouncing and do it with different people and stuff like that. And just, even in the auditions, I remember the pictures. I had a scullion with like a gray scullion. Cause I think I didn't, and I took it off when necessary, but I didn't have a haircut. So I had the scullion and it was like a knit scully. But at the end of that day, I met Terry Wilson, Terry.
Yeah.
And then she ended up being, she was a photographer there. And then from that day, I kept in contact with Terry. And then after doing Genesis, when we shot that scene, then me and Terry for like the next few years worked together on every single project. I was at Terry's house all the time
you and Terry definitely built a great rapport with each other, and every time I turn around, Terry was sending me something, you know, a web series pilot or you know, it was just one thing after another. I kept seeing both of you just turning stuff out.
So that was the and then that was the beginning, because at my school they had like a small film festival that I was like, okay, I want to, at first it was like the validation of knowing that like I'm an actor and I want to be accepted by people. So I did it and I was like, I want to win this Best Actor Award. Won it at my school by doing this little movie I did. And then wanting to learn more, me and Terry did different things. And then just from doing the independent stuff, end up getting like an agent from like some movie I did by myself on my own. I did like, I shot, edited, did everything on like a one man movie I did. Got an agent, started auditioning. And then, eventually, like me and Terry ended up, I think I booked like one show, which was Constantine on NBC. I booked one show that had like one scene, and then me and Terry won the Academy Award, like the Student Academy Award at the Oscars.
Yeah.
So we did that project together. That then took me to the Oscars. I did that. And then from that moment was like pretty much the kickoff to like people wanting to see me. And then I got better as an actor. And then then it just became about how like the acting just took off so much that I got away from doing my own projects.
Yeah.
And then I did them with her. And then we did a movie that went to the Cannes. I still don't know how it's pronounced, but we did a movie that went there. We did a few projects that were like on Virgin Airlines for like 3 months at a time. Like three of our movies were on the airplane, playing at a time. But that was the beginning was just like the lack of auditioning that I was getting and the fact that I was like so much like, okay, I have to do something.
You gotta keep working. Yeah.
It just became us just putting our brains together, coming up with unique ideas and just making our own movies.
Yeah. Yeah. How, so then was it the Academy opportunity that then sealed the deal for you with Los Angeles, or had you come back to Atlanta?
Oh yeah, I came back to Atlanta. I moved to California 2 years ago, and that was in 2015. So like that funny enough, like at that moment, I was like, oh man, I gotta move to LA. But the agent I just signed with, he was I think I booked maybe a few other projects right before that. Mm-hmm. But he didn't want me to move because he was like, obviously, like, you know, I was like one of his early signed actors to this new agency, and he didn't want me to go because he believed in me. And then I knew I wanted to move to LA then when I went, and I just, every time I experienced it, every time I went there, it felt good. Sure. And then like years later, like from 2015 to 2018. Yeah. It took a minute, but we got there when it was God's time.
Man, say a word.
Yeah.
Before we go forward, we are going to go forward fairly quickly here. I just wanted to, since you
they're gonna Scully
audition photos. This was it.
Yep, that's the Scully.
Let's see. Let me.
Oh, this is a video. Oh, yeah, pictures. Yeah.
I think that might have been before you. Oh, there it is.
Yeah.
Yep.
I knew it. I knew it. I knew I had on the Scully.
Oh wow. Yeah, and this audition, we had a blast. We had we just had such amazing people come through. Mm-hmm. The filming process, we ended up shooting quite a bit of the film, actually, and then all the footage was stolen.
Really?
When my car was stolen, and it had really? had all of the gear in it, and had all the drives, the hard drives. I remember taking portions of the film to Bermuda. And there was this whole event there. Danny Glover was there, the president, she's not called a president, they are called the premier. She was the premier of Bermuda. And it just went over so well, and then it was stolen. It was gone.
It's a great idea. It's still to this day is an amazing idea.
There's one video of you in a fight rehearsal. I'm going to play that, and then we're going to move on because I know
I remember this. Look at me wearing these scuffs. What was I doing at the time? I was like, I ain't had no haircut.
Wait a minute. Oh, I think these are all stills. Okay. Yeah, these are all stills. Yeah. I'll have to break them out some other time and take you down memory lane and share some of these, some of these oldies but goodies with the students. How are you faring during the pandemic? How's your health? How's your family?
My family is great. I thought you might see somebody dancing in the background at some point, but my family is good. I'm really excited to be home. I think that for me, I feel like, and I'm a spiritual person. So like, I feel like it's been a moment where God has said like, just be still, you know, like don't rush it. Don't force yourself to like, try to be creative and productive. Like just be still. I left LA. I came home. I've been here for like since Saturday, messing with everybody in the house. Just like rebuilding my energy. But that has been it. And just today, I got a call about possibly producing a project like in Atlanta. So I was like, okay, so like now I've been like on the phone this morning trying to get things going and like, okay, what can we do? What can we, how, you know, when can we do it and stuff like that? But, and then really also be like right before, I don't know if you got a chance to see it, but I shot a sizzle for the show I wrote called Chariot. And
the car dealership.
Yeah. So we shot that and I met with Netflix like 2 days after the sizzle was shot, like literally after production, Netflix wanted to meet with me on a Monday, but that was like the next day. So I was like, can we do Tuesday? So I had the editor come transcode while we were shooting, take it. He did a rough cut. I took the rough cut and I was like, which was a beautiful rough cut. We threw some color on it, gave it some sparkles and then took it into them. And I was supposed to have a follow-up meeting with them. And like Hulu was also, like right when they shut down LA on the weekend, now I flew from, I shot something in Atlanta, flew back to LA on Sunday, was supposed to have a meeting on Monday with this guy because we're gonna take the show into Hulu on like that, I think like Wednesday, but they shut everything down. So like every every meeting was shut down, everything just stopped. And I was like, man, like, this was my moment. Like, this is it, God, what are we doing? Yeah. But I realized, I was like, you know what? Like, take a moment. And then, like, now I have, like, I feel this, even being on this call, like, it's giving me this, not even motivation, because I didn't need to be motivated to do work. It just, I feel like now it's time. I have, like, two other ideas that I made some calls today. So, like, now I'm going to, like, do the script Bible, start a draft on a pilot, like, get things done now. So I could just not take one thing in there and say, like, hey, Hulu, hey, Netflix, here's one thing. But then now I can say, like, here's three ideas that I have that are, that, like, fit what you guys need. And then instead of just being like, oh, here's this one thing. So what else you got, Patrick?
Right. You know, take it, so looking,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, I could bring him, I could do more now. And I have confirmation that, like, hey, Patrick, as soon as this is over, you'll come in, we'll meet, you come to the whatever, and we do the dance. And, you know,
how did you grow that confidence? How did you grow that muscle of, you know what, I when I go into this space, I need to be the one who's essentially leading the conversation by being able to present what I want to present?
Well, I think it's troubling for, like, and there's so many people that are, like, watching this or whatever, but I think it's troubling when you're a person who feels like they're supposed to do a specific thing, but you can't do it, or, like, or you feel that you can't do it. So I try to, so I feel like God giving the confidence in what exactly I'm supposed to do, believing highly in, like the fact that, like, we speak those things that be not as though they were. Like, before I even went to the Academy Awards, like, I saw it in my brain at my job. Like, every week I would go, like, and stand on the top of, like, a ladder, and during break time and just, like, look at this audience, to then, like, in 4 years be able to see the audience that I saw in my brain. So I think, like the knowing that what I see for my future, what I feel like God has given me a preview of, that if I don't do the work, then it'll never happen. So essentially, it's like, hey, it's supposed to happen for you. I showed you already. So, like, now you gotta, like, do what you, like, you got something in that brain, like, put it to work. So I think, like, knowing that it's already mine before I have it, is what gives me the confidence. Cause, like, when you don't, and even, like, and honestly, like, in this, I'll be real with everybody watching, in this time of, like, not, like, I act, like, for acting, it was not, like, from 2016 to 2019 was literally, like, it was, I did 10 episodes in The Resident, we did Power, did the 3 episodes with them, The Grey's Anatomy popped right in between, then we did, like, I did a movie over here in this city, movie in this city, it was like, boom, 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 show, boom, 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 prepare for the show, shoot this thing, it was so much of that, and then it just, like, then it stopped, and I was like, okay. And then that just pushed me towards, like, going back to, like, what I started with, which was, what got me my first agent was doing my own projects. What got me, like, people to even look at who I was doing my own thing. Everything has always been back to doing my own stuff. And it's like, now I've done a product that people can look at and say, like, okay, this is something. We already know that you can act. Like, cause Netflix, they people like, okay, you already good enough to lead a show. So, like, one of my friends who works up there says, hey, you write a show, create it around you. You pitch yourself when you go in there because they need Black people. They need minorities. So write something, pitch yourself, and then, like, and bring it in and just, you know, like, see how it works. So I think the confidence just knows from, like, nobody gonna do it for me, you know? Yeah. So.
Yeah. Before you get into your lecture, I'm gonna do a screen share on your Instagram.
Great.
And I want to run the clip, but is it this one?
Yes.
Okay, so I want to run this, y'all, because this is a great example of someone seizing an opportunity to do the work and showcase who they are, what they do. I know Pavin Franklin earlier today had this question of, you know, what should I shoot? Anything. just pick up your camera and shoot. And I love this piece. Hold on, let me.
We just don't think we can afford it.
Yeah, we can't do that every month. Well, I'm sure we can work something out. I will
any discount. There you go.
Well, you're a ladies' man, and this is a car that ladies love. What do you think?
I hate that van. Your family deserves this. You work too hard to be in that crappy van. I hate that van. What do you see me at?
This is the best car that you'll find. Who gonna pay for it?
Who wants to pay for it? How many cars you sell this week?
Six.
The honest way.
Three. Ooh, I'll get better though.
You better.
Enjoy the new car. It is raining money, man. That's four today.
He's stealing from the dealership.
They only offered you $1,500.
What are you talking about? Not Danny.
Yes, Danny. He's doing side hustle and making profits off it.
35. Great. My little brother needs it. Thank you so much.
Come on, man. I really need to buy that lot.
Bro, I'll give you double by Friday. You have my word.
Bottom line is, I just can't let you get away with stuff like that. Danny, you're fired.
How much money I made last month selling five cars?
$30,000.
You mean $30,000 profit or $30,000 total?
Total. It was 15 profit.
Well, 14. Some
old lady got a deal.
Well, I can use 15 grand a month.
Yeah, I can do a lot with that, bro.
I'm paying you $3,000 cash.
Which one of these motherfuckers is it?
The one in the red shirt, baby.
Oh, you're talking about
you. You're so you for who wants.
I know. Your business is struggling. But I will do whatever it takes to keep you paid and money in your pockets.
I'm in.
Oh, hey, stop this motherfucking way! You get it, bro! You don't get it, you're gonna get it too! I'm in.
Yeah.
You are, bro. No, I don't know, bro. Shut it down.
You know you run a risk when my company invests.
Yes.
We enjoy the new people of the business. As soon as they clear them with us. You guys will love this car.
So, my man, I lost my ever-loving mind when you first dropped that. And you dropped pieces at a time leading up to it. Like, right. That wasn't, you didn't, you know, you there were these shorter pieces right, of a puzzle that, you know, you're sitting here going, wait, he's selling cars? Oh, no, he's not selling cars. Oh, he is. But what? And it was just so many little mini pieces that added to this buildup, the suspense. So then when that revealed more, I'm just like, I'm full, but I want more. What? How did you come up with this idea? How did you shoot it? Tell us how you put this together, and then I'm gonna have you teach us a thing as if that's not already happening. Go for it.
And I dropped the link to the project for people to go in and they can watch it on the side, the Vimeo link. But so first of all, so I was like, Patrick, like, what do you do best, right? Like, out of all the young, amazing Black actors in Hollywood, like, what is it that, what is it that I do best? I think that there is this, I get callbacks often for roles that require heavy emotion. It's always gonna be something that, like, is, I was offered, we were up for a role on the, and I say we, because it's me up for a role, but like my representation, it's always we. I don't do like I, always we.
Mm-hmm.
So we were up for they don't want me to do specific things like a 24 episode, doctor show, like The Resident. It could only be guest star. I can't be like, we're not looking for the every episode. Cause like it lacks creativity. So it's like, you could do it, but it's like, they want like a This Is Us or like someone that like my talents already would just be able to just pop on easy. So I was like, what can I do well? And it was selling. I feel like I can sell anything, in my opinion. Selling is just really easy. So I said, what if we had this guy? And my favorite actor is Daniel Day-Lewis. And my favorite actor is Denzel Washington. The best actor of all time is Daniel Day-Lewis. But like, he's not my favorite. Denzel's my favorite, but Daniel Day-Lewis is just like, it's just the most dynamic. So I said, like, what movies work? What movies hit? It was like your Wolf of Wall Streets, your like the shows that have some sense of like a character that has to be, that has to make decisions really fast and really and like deep characters that almost were like, I don't know, like I wanted to do something that was, that had legs to it. Cause this wasn't even my passion project. It was just something that I knew I could sell. I was like, okay, this would be good on Netflix. A show that is like about a young guy who sells cars, gets fired from his job, decides to then go and brings his friends in who do their jobs and teach them how to sell cars. And it's like the dirt that lies in the car industry. And just watching like one dude like really develop like this, addiction to more. And then like, he wants to run the entire car industry. He moves from like Clayton County and like outside of Atlanta into like Atlanta in like the second and third season. So it's like watching, hey, bro, Adria, I want to call. Stop, bro.
He was ready to turn up. It's Baby Friday. He was like, we good. Yeah.
So it was just about, for me, just creating a show that had legs. So when I go into a meeting and they say, hey, Patrick, what is your season one look like? I have my script Bible of like my season one. And I say, okay, season two, we can go this direction and this can go into season three and then season four. So it was just an idea that I knew that I could create legs with and that worked. As far as like how we did it, it was, we had like a small, I think we had like a 15 man crew. It was every dime that I had into this project in December. I shot it around my birthday. Every dime that was in my bank account went towards this. It's so bad that going into January, February have been the hardest months of some of the hardest months of my life, because everything I had went into shooting a sizzle, not even a full project, but just a sizzle reel for a project that I believed in just so much. Like the budget was like, I think we did like 14 grand to put that together. We shot with the Alexa LF. That was like the newest Alexa at the time. Somebody gave us a great camera package deal where we had to shoot it. It wasn't even like, at first I didn't have the money, so I was like, okay, I'll shoot it in next year. But the deal that we got was just so fantastic that I couldn't say no to it. And then, I mean, we got people together and they just really believed in the story that I was telling, but the entire crew, and this is something that I had as far as like teaching, it was like any for filmmakers, any moment that you have to champion to champion somebody on set, I think is important. Any moment, if a director or director, primarily a director, but anybody who runs a set, I think moments of knowing everybody's name is really important. And moments of saying good job is important. Moments of just like saying like, so that way everybody knows that they're seen. because the guy who's gaffing your project at the end of the day, who's putting up the C-stands and he's the main gaffer's assistant, he does not feel, he doesn't feel a sense of, I belong here sometimes. And I know that because I started a gaff like recently. So like, I know what it's like to do every job. And that was another note I had, like, learn as many jobs as you can. But I think us all being together, I had meetings before we shot every day that where I prayed with everybody. And I said, honestly, I said, I'm just like me and this other dude. I said, we're just young Black boys who are from like just very humble beginnings and we're trying to do something great. And then everybody just jumped on board and Black, white, Hispanic, Indian, like all these people on this crew just to make something great. And we shot it in 3 days. It was challenging, but it was just so fun. I mean, it was fun. I mean, I would never forget shooting that project. Never, ever.
It completely has the fingerprints of your whole entire spirit all over it. It doesn't even look like, you know, yet another project someone will put together. It really works even better than even a reel, because in that 5 minutes, 4 minutes, 20 some seconds, we see a full range of your skill set. We see some of the intense dramatic moments. We also see some lighter moments of comedy and levity. We see someone who has the potential of a romantic lead in the ways that you related to some of the female characters in that clip. We right. see there's the mad leader kind of gangster texture that you can have, but we also right. see, you know, something of the nerdy side where you're you know, working with numbers and stuff.
Right, very much.
And what that piece was or is a fantastic showcase for you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So tell you what, I'm gonna mute my mic. I'm gonna give it over to you. You're already teaching us so many things today. Great. Patrick, why don't you go ahead and take over and teach us a thing?
Okay. How much time do I have?
You got about 10 minutes.
Great. Okay, so first, as far as like, I'm not even going to speak. If anybody has any questions, you can write them on the side. I now have like this chat pulled up, so I'm like, I know where the chat is. So any questions about anything else will work. And I'm also like like I make my money by like acting and acting coaching. Like I teach classes in Atlanta and Los Angeles, but I'm going to focus more on just filmmaking as a whole. Like the number one thing that I have is being original. Like that's the number one thing that I can advise, because the reality is that everybody has an idea. Everybody has something that they're like, this is the thing. This is what this network needs. This is what this network needs. This is what, like, I have the thing. And if everybody feels as if they have the thing, I feel like you have to, okay, there's a question already. As a student actor, what should I be doing in order to get roles? What are you doing? Okay, there's a few. Great. Oh, there they go. They're popping in. Actually, I'm gonna talk about it first, then I'll do the questions. I forgot what I was saying. But being original, like always, like I think that TV is the best guide for trying to find out where you fit. So I can look at TV right now and go through all these channels and research every project, especially being a young Black dude, and say, okay. This is what TV does not have. It's obviously harder for Caucasians. It's a lot harder because everything on TV is generally Caucasian. So anything else, if you, in any minority, I feel like you can look at all the shows, a few episodes and say, okay, I have, like, now you know, like, I have something that works here. For me, I'm not trying to make the big drug show. It's been done. Power's a fantastic show. And they got like a book two, book three, book four, book five. They're going to be on drugs for a very long time. So I'm good on the drug game. It's just finding ways to like be original and bring something in. That's why Get Out changed everything, because of the fact that we had never seen something like that before. Same as, in my opinion, the movie The Sixth Sense. It's just something that like was just revolutionary for the time, but it's timeless to like now I watch it and I feel like it's one of the best movies ever created to get a reaction out of an audience, to make them, like historically in the box office, their first week wasn't good. Their second, third, fourth weeks, then they broke the records in the following weeks with the word of mouth and people going back to watch it a second time. So making things that sit well with audiences. So being original and like learning as many jobs as you can. So how? Man, this is for people who want to act and people who just want to direct. I feel like a director, it's important when a director goes into an acting class because he has a point of view of where an actor is coming from. So it's easy to say like, hey, actor, do this thing. But if you have experienced it or if you've at least tried to like study it, then you would have a better view on it. That's why like, I know when I watch movies, I know if an actor directed it, I can feel it. Because of the choices that are being made and the shot choices. Denzel, when he directs very much, he's gonna live in a beautiful close-up and like he's gonna move around with a close-up. I'm the same way. I just love to see this. And they won't rely on like a wide as much because they want to tell the story. They want the audience to see the story that's being told in the actor's eyes. So like learning jobs, because like if the actor knows as much about the camera as possible, okay. Make sure my dog not near me. Okay. Okay, on set. Anytime I'm shooting a scene, generally I'm gonna ask, what is my frame? So if I'm here if the person with the camera is on a steady cam, he's across from me, then I need to know what the frame is to know, okay, you shoot with a 35 millimeter, I know it's gonna be here. If it's a 50, I know they're going tight. I can already know those things before I have to look at it on the monitor after the fact, you know? And I'm like, oh, well, I wonder what that looked like. Or like, I wonder when to use the emotion. Because like, if you're doing 50 takes on a scene and they're gonna use, they're gonna shoot, they'll tell you, we're gonna do the wide shot first. So you do bigger, you could do more actions in a wide. You never wanna do a lot of actions on a close-up because the camera's right here. So if I'm moving too much, then it's too much happening on screen and it'll look funny when you look at it on a close-up, but in a wide shot you could do more. And if it's an emotional scene, you save it typically for those closer moments. Great, I see some more questions. I'm going to answer those in 2 seconds. So yeah, learn as many jobs as you can on set in general, being original, watch and learn. Okay, great. I had if you pay attention, I think that's where most of the learning comes from, paying attention. Again, I'm an actor first. So to be an actor on a set, what they will do is they'll say, I have the big trailer in the back, right? All of the actors' trailers over there. I can sit beautifully in this nice trailer that they have for me and eat a bunch of the food that they have for me. Or I can choose to be proactive and come onto the set because I'm the actor. Then they're not gonna tell an actor to go back. Like, they're not gonna say, go back in the trailer. They may say, go sit at a cast chair, but they'll bring the cast chair to the monitors if you want to see what's happening. Even with Power, like Power was one of my favorite shows before I got on it. So I got to set early just to see Omari Ghost do scenes so I could see exactly what does he do? What does he do? How does he move? Like, what is this thing that he does? In this, if you watch Power, Ghost has like a stare, like he has this moment where he'll just stare off and it's like this iconic Ghost stare. So what it'll do is, if the scene is this way, all he does is just cheats his body out and just looks into nowhere. But it just looks good it gives the audience a chance to see that the character is thinking, right? Because, and they do it on a lot of shows, but Ghost is the man at it. Because like, he'll sit, he'll look, he'll do his evil look out, and then the editor will let it sit for like 3 to 4 seconds. But in that 3 to 4 seconds, it gives the audience a chance to go, okay, he's about to go kill that person. We fill in the thoughts that like Omari can literally, he could just look. And then, but just in that space that he gives, it gives the audience a chance to then fill in his thoughts. Something I learned about acting early on was it is about like an actor is supposed to, you're supposed to be able to see him think or see him or her, see them think on screen. So if I'm in this specific scene or moment, if I'm hurt, you should be able to see me, like see my wheels. If I'm getting angry, you should be able to see it process and generate into the moment that I explode into. So if someone's talking, if someone is, and they do this, I'm watching How to Get Away with Murder. I just started this show, I'm on like season 2. But characters will say things like, you're not worth anything. You're not gonna be anything. Nobody loves you. In those moments, my moment, like before they said that, I was just normal. But once they say that, during that line, they'll cut back to me. They'll watch me. You can watch me get, like, you can watch the intensity build and then watch me hit on the next line. But it's just like, it's the moment before the explosion is the most interesting. It's like the part we get to watch the actor think. It's talked about a lot just now, but if you pay attention in any opportunity that you have on anybody's set, I just worked on an independent set, like right before this whole coronavirus. And I was acting. They flew me into Atlanta to work on a project, and it was independent, but a great pilot. They're gonna pitch it and hopefully get it picked up. But I watched the gaffers more than I watched anything else. I knew the camera already. I knew what they were doing. I knew what mistakes they were making, what they weren't. I wasn't worried about it because I'm there to act. But like how they set up specific lights was my goal. So I was like, hey, I'm here. I'm getting paid a little bit of money to be here. My agents don't know much about what I'm doing besides it's something that I care about. But my payment is watching these boys put this light up on the roof where there is no, like how they connect things onto the roof and how they're able to just move things around. Like that was my, like, that's where I got paid. Cause I took pictures and I took videos and I was like, bit, all right, cool. Hey, what's that called? Okay, great. Like paying attention to everything and soaking up all the information that I could. Great. So I will answer some of these questions on here. Oh, I have more time. Do I go into the Q&A after?
Yeah, I was going to say, you know what? Let's go ahead and open up your mics and that way he doesn't have to read the questions. Go ahead and ask him.
Great.
Oh, okay. Hey.
Oh. Tell you what, I'm going to go to the questions and I'll so Juwan, why don't you go with your question first? Cause you were pretty high up, and then Amarachi, and then I'll and then John Shea.
Great.
Okay, so hey Patrick. So my first question is, as a student actor, like what should I be doing right now in order to be getting roles out of school? Because once I graduate, you know, I wanna go straight into acting, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of like that transition from how do I go from, okay, I just graduated to boom, I'm already into something. Or what should be my next move, I guess, what I'm asking.
What city are you guys in? Texas, right?
We're Houston, in Houston.
Yeah. Houston. Oh yeah, Houston. Okay, cool. Okay. So one thing I know about Houston is that, which is ironic, I know when there's an agent out in Houston. I can't think of the name, but it's one of the biggest agents. I was in LA like they invited me to like a play, to see a play. Mm-hmm. And then this agent that came and was talking to me about like the film industry in Houston. And she was saying she wanted me to come and like do a project in Houston. Cause like it was, the industry was going down, but she said there was still stuff there enough to like have big agencies there. So if I were you, just Patrick Walker's advice, I would focus on, first of all, getting better. Cause the question is like, how, like, do you feel like you're good enough to have an agent, right?
Okay.
So it is like going to the classes, like going into acting classes and like learning, like, I'm sure there's something in Houston. And actually there's a guy named Troy Rowland. I can like put his stuff in later on, but my acting coach name is Troy. He goes to Houston and does these workshops in Houston where he works with a bunch of actors. And I think my class is going to Houston to do something in Houston soon too, to teach classes. But like really learning about what the industry is about, what the industry is, but just like who you are. Because I feel like once the person knows who they are, they know where they can pull from. For a great example, we have this acting exercise where it's called ACD. So what we do is, the coach will say, it's angry comedy drama. It's a very difficult exercise. But what you do is you stand, you do, and you go level 10 anger for like, I think it's about 30 seconds to a minute. He'll snap, you turn around, and then you take like a second, and then you turn back. And when you turn back, you go straight into comedy. And then he'll snap again after like 45 seconds, you turn around and then going straight into drama. But that exercise is more than just watching people just yell and get angry and upset and then watching them do something funny and then watching them drop a tear for you. But it's like them knowing when they can't get to it, like he'll ask what, like be angry about something that you know of right now in your life, or like be like something that's funny to you right now, or like something that will make you cry right now, you know? And then you, in that exercise, you find out like who you actually are. So like I would work on like self-discovery, but like also just going to like finding a class that you can go to, or creating a class like amongst like peers where you go and you pull scenes from movies and you work on those scenes, or like you do improv together, but finding ways to keep it sharp. And then I always advise like shooting your own projects, because like at the end of the day, I can't even tell you what you do better than you. Like, you know what it is that you do best. You know what role right now, I'm gonna look into the camera with this. You know what role right now that you would murder more than you feel like anybody. That's why I wrote that show. I wrote it because I was like, I don't feel like there's nobody in my age range right now who could sell something, and like who could sell, then turn, then do this emotion, then turn and give you a tear in that fast of a time frame, as fast as I can. It's just something that I knew that I could do best. Yeah. So like creating things, writing things, shooting short films, doing things that you feel like you practice those things, because you're doing it now. By the time you get to wherever you move to do whatever acting work you want to do, this is all practice in my brain. Like how I see it is everything is practice, because I have done, no lie, a scene where somebody is dying on the ground in my arms and I'm crying so many times on independent projects that when they put out a big camera in front of me, it was nothing to sit there and like on Grey's Anatomy, I had to cry with my baby in my arms. It was nothing to do it, because I had done it in so many independent projects and had to like sit in emotion, sit in like a dark corner or whatever like that. Grey's Anatomy or The Resident, where I had to just sit and like find it. It's like, it was easier to just get to it because I had already practiced it for years. I know those, I know even like bad characters. I done did so many bad guys in short films. When it's time to be bad, it's not in a certain way, it's not extremely challenging because I done practiced it for so long. The world just hasn't seen it. So the moment that it's time for like specific characters, like it'll be nothing to go into. And people are like, oh, well, how long did you prepare for that role? My whole career? Because I've been having to do this for the whole time. You know, but like I would just advise like shooting your own projects and just like getting people to learn like the craft. Cause like acting it is, I mean, it's a craft. It's something that you take and you watch, and like these, like what makes Denzel Washington, it's not his character work. It is the fact that we enjoy seeing Denzel in different scenarios. That's the basic idea of an audience, is they like to see Denzel in a different scenario, whether he's saving his kid, like robbing the hospital, or whether he is a cop. They like to see him do his thing. So it's also finding out like what kind of actor you want to be. A character actor? Is it like an actor like a Johnny Depp who could just dig into Jake Gyllenhaal, I say better, where they could just dig in and just like go from here to Daniel Day-Lewis, who can go from here to here to here to here. Or you play like a Denzel, who is the best at doing what he does. I mean, just really finding out like who you are and learning more about like the craft itself. You know, like that's what I would advise. Cause at that moment, you'll know when you're ready. Like I was in school, stay in school. How old are you?
I'm 22.
22, okay, cool. I'm 27. So like I went to school for like, I think two semesters and I left. Just because I knew that like this wasn't work. Like, and it was that I like school because I like knowledge. So I really enjoy being there. But God has something else for me. He took me out of there and then took me on a different path. But like, people often say like, oh, I'm in school. I can't do anything. I can't go do it. I can't do this. I can't do that. I would say, we'll learn. So that way when it's time to like drop, like when it's time to graduate, appreciate you. Thank you for that diploma. My man, appreciate you. You ready to go into the world and like, you've already worked these skills already.
Yeah. Amarachi, you have a question, dear.
Yes, I'm not gonna turn my video on because
come on.
It's just no need.
Come on.
Please use your imagination. But okay, so I have two questions. I'm just gonna make them one. Mm-hmm. So what are your tips for doing like self-submissions and submitting like through yourself? And also, when do you think is the best time to move to LA or Atlanta, during episodic season or during pilot season?
So I answer the first question, the second question first. The reality is that like my agents will say that there's not much of a pilot season anymore. It's a thing, it's like, because things are changing so much that a general pilot season is gonna last from, it's gonna really kick on in February, mainly after Sundance. So right after Sundance, everybody leaves Sundance with the inspiration, and then they go to their offices and they're ready to work. So like into like February, on to February, March, April, May, it may start to slow down. May, June, it'll start to slow down. But like, because pilots are done all the time now, it's not much of a, there's a pilot season. It's good to be there at the beginning of a year to be able to like, you know, be there. But like, if it was me, I would go, and I'm not telling you when to go, but if I was to, if I made up my mind, hey, I'm gonna move to LA next year, I wouldn't move at the beginning of a year. I would move right before the year started, because if you come, if you go to LA in January, they can't meet with you because pilot season is starting. So they're not really going to have them that much opportunity to meet.
They're shooting at the beginning of February.
Yeah, they
so
already
you've already missed the boat.
Exactly. So it's important to be there. If you have no agent, to go there in like your October, November's, go and have the go and meet
graduation.
With them. Say again.
So like after graduation. So if I graduated in May and I wanted to move.
Yeah, if I graduated in May, I would get myself together May, because there's obviously like connections and stuff like that you have where you are. So May, I would take May, June, July. I would, if it was me, I would move like in like, if it was like September, October, so somewhere between September, October, November, just because I can then start to send my stuff out to agents. If you move at the beginning of the year, you can still send headshots and stuff, but.
Right, and like an acting reel, should I get maybe like 3 videos together to send off?
Acting reel, like stuff like that makes it easier for them to know that you're, it's good for them to know like, okay, this person can do this. Like my acting reel, because when you first start, the reality is they're not expecting you to have like a super extensive resume or acting reel. They know that, they know you're just starting. They know that's why you need an agent. So that's why like doing independent projects and stuff like that, it comes in handy to like build your acting reel. Cause I think like my acting reel was really just a bunch of projects that I did and like a few other projects. But I mean, now it's like, I mean, obviously now it's like, you know, only network projects, but I mean, it is great for them to have something that they can see that says, okay, we can see the potential in this person if you were to move.
Yeah.
Thank you so
John
much.
John Shea, your question.
All right, how you doing? So my question is, being a man of many talents, because you have many talents, and then I also have a lot of talents, like being a hip-hop artist, videographer, photographer, cinematographer, writer. So how do you know what to put your energy into for the most efficient outcome?
I think it depends on what you believe in, right? It's all on like what you feel. I knew for a fact that like, as much as I liked acting, I loved acting. But I knew that in order to act, I needed to create the thing that would help me act. Because like, everybody, like I said to my brother before, like there's not many people that know what you do best. So it's like, because I couldn't act all the time is why I started to then do these other things and then became good at these other things. But like at the end of the day, I think it's whatever you know you do the best is where like I feel like you should put the time into, because then you were in the door, right? Prime example, a show, right? I did a show and I'm in the door because they know that I'm an actor already. They know like, okay, he's the guy on the resident. He's that dude, or he's the guy from this, he's the guy from that. So there's a sense of familiarity from like what I already do. So that could get me in the door to bring in all the other stuff. So it's like, but I'm gonna put my money where like the thing I do best is, and then like these other things I'll bring them along as well. So like if like you said, what all do you do? You said cinematographer, you said a magician, you said a crafts, what all? You said hip-hop artist.
Yeah, videographer, photographer, I paint, I do graphic design, sound engineering, foley artist.
Yeah,
everything that I could think of.
And see, you could do projects that involve all those things and then just bring them all together. But like, if like whatever it is that your heart really wants, like the like first, I would go for it. Like, and I hate that I have to keep using Denzel, but he's the easiest person to me. He did his acting first and then he started to direct because he knew that he wanted to do that as well, which is a lot of actors, they realize that like they want to do it. Actually, if you watch your favorite shows, after the second season, you'll start to see them be the executive producer on most big shows. You'll see it'll be Breaking Bad, which is, in my opinion, like the greatest show ever created. Bryan Cranston's name was not just the first actor, but then it was the the executive producer. Like, and then it's like, you know, so it's like they find ways to do other things, which is the money. But they know what they came there to do first. So like whatever you do first, I would nourish that, and then on your off time, nourish all the other things, you know, in my opinion.
We are approaching that time to bring it to a halt. Let me allow Justice to hop in there and ask his question, because I had to cut. He was the cutoff on the previous speaker as well, and I hate to do it to him twice. Go ahead. If you got a quick question, Justice,
and I'll make it quick too. I'll make the answer quick.
There you go. Go for it.
Okay. So what's up, man? My name is Justice. So my quick question was, I wanted to ask about the scene where it's you, Kate, and Ghost, right? I wanted to ask, what was the emotional process in doing that scene? Because I think the stare-offs that y'all had was like top tier, you know what I'm saying? Man. So that was my quick question that I had that I wanted to ask.
That ain't no quick answer, but I'll give it to you quick. That's a good question though, bro. What was the question? So it said, what was the emotional
process of going through that scene?
Okay, quickly, the emotional process, honest to you, what I did was they gave me a gun beforehand. They took me to like gun training, which was like, I had to shoot a gun in the air, which I'd already done it before, but I knew what my gun was. Mm-hmm. So beforehand, I chose the gun I wanted to use in that scene. And I had them to, that was the first thing I found when I got there that day. I said, where's my gun? Like, where's the gun? Because it gave me a sense of like I belong here, but this is my space. And what I would do is I found a wall. There was a wall that like I'd like, because it was like this whole club with all these people and everybody kind of watching you as the actor do your thing. And it's like to get away, I would like just sit in a wall and like, I wasn't like yelling at the wall, but I would just talk to the wall and just be like, I would talk my way through the scene. I would talk like my way through my thoughts, but I would just sit and like build the energy. And I gave him, like I said, that he was on drugs before he went in. That was his motivation for it. So like when I go into the scene and have these moments, it feels very like on edge. And then me and Omari would bounce lines really fast. We did fast line readings. So like my line, your line, my line, your line, my line, your line, my line, your line. It's just really fast. A lot of those lines we just ad-lib, but like we went through it, but like we made sure that it was like that you could feel the emotion that was brought. But I had to organically scare him, because like he not gonna just act scared, you know. So as I had to like actually like be there and just really like scare them with this thing in my hand, because that works best for them as actors. And he was like, yo bro, you gotta shake me up if you come in here, like you gotta do it. And he would even tell me to say certain things twice. I think there was a line where I say get back or like shut up. So I would say certain things twice, because I needed to feel as if like I was, even though it was all planned, the whole scene was planned by like Ghost. I needed them to know that it was like I was in charge, and you know. So emotionally, I just sat in like a small space and like built it up and like got my hands moving fast, so that when I went in, it was all wah wah, and it was just like, even like off scene, like you can't see it, but like all throughout the scene, it is me dancing with the gun in front of like all these extras and watching them be afraid of me and laughing at those things, you know. So it was like, I mean, that was the emotional preparation for that fun, super fun scene.
Okay, so I know that there's some outstanding questions that are in the chat. When the call ends, what will happen is that Zoom will catalog all of those questions and then give it to me. It'll create a document for me. What I am going to do is I'm going to email those questions to Patrick.
Right.
And I'm going to ask Patrick to, if he could give like a 2-3 sentence, don't go into any major diatribes, maybe, yeah, you know, even on your cell phone, yeah, hey, this question is from, you know, and, you know, just do a quick like 30 second answer, yeah, to it. And that might help, because there's some more really great questions here.
Yeah. Wait, I can't hear you. Wait, I can't hear. No.
Disappeared on God.
What happened?
It's probably her connection.
we can come up with a construct for getting all of their questions answered as best you can, because they're dynamic questions.
Sure. That sounds
good. Yeah. Patrick. Brother, thank you so much.
No problem.
I just can't say enough of I can't say how proud of you I am.
I appreciate it.
Hey, can I see you on, well, for Easter?
Oh. Say it again.
She didn't realize her mic wasn't muted. But I'm so incredibly proud of you. And I am a huge fan of your work. And I'm a huge fan of your work ethic. And I think the work ethic is what drives the work. And yeah, it's apparent and evident. And I'm going to use your Instagram account as a textbook and have these young people watch and rewatch and watch again. And I'll connect with you and get these questions to you, and we'll figure out a way to make it all work.
Great. That sounds amazing. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate everybody for their questions and just listening to me just for that whole time. It's so fun.
All right, my friend. Thank you all. Thank everyone who's on the call today. I hope you have a great weekend. Join us again next week. Next week is much more focused towards broadcast news, broadcast journalism. We have some PV alum who, right out of graduation, landed some awesome jobs as news reporters. And they're going to give us some insight on what prep work they did, because they did the work while they were still at Prairie View to arm them with the best opportunities to get the jobs they wanted in the news industry. And Tia Johnson is going to join us on Tuesday. Jordan Foster and Lamaya Harvell are going to join us on Thursday. We have some additional people mixed in through there as well, who work in television in different capacities, work in PR in different capacities. And so, you know, we really started off with, you know, some strong writers. The second day we moved into like four, if we count Tamika. I tried to get all four of them in the same day, but those four women are pretty much my personal tribe. And then we went into, you know, film, directing, writing, acting. So next week we're going to get into journalism. And Patrick, again, thank you so much. I love you. And we'll see y'all. Have a great weekend. All right. Appreciate it. Bye.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.